Hello everyone, Göksu Karaca. My teammates are Metehan Uzun, Mert İhsan Uz, and Bengisu Doğan. This term for our senior project, we choose to develop a system for marble detection. Today we would like to talk about pre-processing the data and training and testing our model. Our aim for this project is providing convenience to manufacturers and consumers in the construction sector. Mainly, we want to determine the type of marble without the need for an expert person. We are gathering our own data set. We collect our data from advertisement agencies, from Afyonkarahisar and Muğla. Also, we get data from an article published by Can Ayaz and Uluda from Yüzüncü Yıl University. You can see some samples from our data set. Firstly, we split our data into two groups, train and test data. After that, we split our training data into two groups, training and validation data. We have 1,109 train images, 72 validation data, and 54 test data. But I want to mention that this is just for now. We are developing every day. For the record, I want to mention that marbles have unique lines. These lines are called veins in the sector. Each marble belonging to a class does not have to have veins of the same length, same width, and these does not have to be in the same location in a piece of marble. And we used image data generator function for our pre-processing state. We rotated, zoomed, and shifted the images. This is done for training and validation data.
May I ask a question, Göksu?
Yes.
In the image data generator, I see that you set up field mode nearest. Am I right?
I couldn't hear you because of my connection, so sorry. Can you please repeat it?
If you go back, here in your data generator, in field mode, you use the nearest option. Am I right?
Yes.
Okay, but in your images next to this code, they didn't get filled. They have the black images or black parts. Why?
I don't have an right question for this, right answer for this question. I don't know.
So do you know what is field mode is?
In my guessing, it's to fill the nearest edge.
Okay. Anybody knows what it is?
We upload wrong photos. Nearest mean it fills nearest pixel of the image and fill the black sides.
So Mert, actually it's related with the rotation, right? Or shifting. If you rotate or shift the image, then there are some places after image shifted or rotated. And how can we fill with this? On your image examples, right side, they are just shifted and zoomed. I think in the below one is zoomed and rotated, but there are black parts. So I think that there shouldn't be any black part if you selected the fill mode nearest. Am I right?
Yeah, you are right, hocam. We upload wrong photos. As you said, the black part will be filled with photos nearest pixels.
Yeah, so it should be copy and paste the nearest pixel over the black ones. Am I right?
You are right.
Okay. Now, I think Göksu, you are present, right? Göksu, what is C-val parameter? C-val, the last parameter.
I don't know that.
Why but, don't you know? You are presenting.
Yes, you are right, but
okay. What about Göksu? Bengisu?
Also, I don't know, teacher.
Okay, so Mert?
It means, hocam, as you mentioned, in machine learning lesson, there is a seawall, I guess.
No, it's not related with this.
I don't know either of those.
Okay, so my point is that when you have some code from some blocks, you copy and paste, make it run, is not enough. You need to understand the parameters. You need to play with these parameters. You need to read more and then use it wisely. Because I could ask several questions like that. Why it is width shift range is only 0.1? Why not 0.25? Do you have any answer for that, Göksu? Yoksa I cannot hear you.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
I said I didn't understand the question.
The question is that there is the second parameter. Do you hear me?
Yes, I can.
Width shift range. It is 0.1. Why it is not 0.25? Why it is 0.1? What's the magic of 0.1?
I don't know. We just maybe wanted to use 0.1.
It's not the correct answer.
So I don't know.
Mert?
Is hyperparameter, hocam.
Yes. Why did you choose 0.1?
We tried with 0.1 and it gives good accuracy and the other performance.
Are you sure what you are talking?
No, I am not.
Because if you look at the validation data, in that width shift range is 0.2 this time.
Yeah, you are right. I change in every.
Do you understand my point, Göksu?
Yes, I understand.
So what I am suggesting to that
teacher?
Yes.
Actually, as you tell us, image data generator doesn't very well working in our data. That's why we don't try every value, but these are like a standard value. We put it and we try it.
Metan, if they are almost everybody's using, why the validation data and train data has different parameter values?
You tell us why.
Look at the train data.
Train data is not
0.1, 0.1. But look at the validation data, 0.20. There should be some reason for it, if there is.
Actually,
by chance, by random, or just random, the confusion?
Random.
So do you understand my point? You cannot explain.
Yes.
Somebody that they are random, that it means that you don't know what you are doing. Do you understand me, Göksu?
Yes.
So if you are presenting some code, you need to know every line. And every line should be adopted by you. Okay, let's continue.
We defined our batch size to 8, and image 8 and weight are fixed to 224. We have 6 classes at this point. These are Afyon Beyaz, Afyon Gray, Beige Marble, Kaplan Postu, Karaca Bey Siyah, and Crystal Improv. In here, every time we run the model will run in a certain methodology, but there's a problem. Every time we run the model, we will get different result, and we do not want this. So we used setSeed function to bind that randomness in a certain way. In this way, we will get the same result every time we run our model. Also, flow from directory function is used, as you can see. In target size, we resize the dimensions for all data. Batch size and classes were mentioned before. We determined our class mode to two-dimensional one-hot encoded label, and so we choose categorical class mode.
Göksu, why did you choose 224 by 224? What's the magic of these numbers?
Actually, while we were araştırmak,
research,
while we were doing our research, actually 224 times 224 was the most common used target size in most of the models, but I am really not sure why we have 224.
Okay, anybody in the team has an idea why 224
by 224? In later, they are using resonance.
Who is talking?
I am Mert İhsan.
Okay, Mert.
We will use in the later resonance model. It gets input 224 size.
But actually, it's not a must here, right, Mert İhsan? If you check this model, you can
set up, right?
Right? Okay.
You are
What's your minimum image size? What's your minimum image size? What is your minimum image size in your data set?
All of them,
224. You have already concluded the EDA. Now you know everything about your data set, I believe. So what is your minimum image size in your data set?
We don't know. We don't remember.
And you have very low number of data. You can use larger image sizes to have better accuracy. Do you understand me?
Yes.
Because you don't have millions of images. If you have, for example, 1.2 million of images, okay, you can resize, downsize it. But you have only 170 images. It is very unwise to downsize it to this thumbnail size. There is no sense for it. You have to make it 1,000 by 1,000, for example. So I am asking that. If your raw data set, the images is 3 million by 3 million, you have to use 3 million by 3 million at least. Do you understand me?
Yeah. Matt,
yes.
Yes, hocam. I understand.
You, but actually, I don't understand why our pixels are that.
Because you can just adjust the model saying that 1024 by 1024 because you have very few number of images. You don't need to downsize it so little number.
In validation data, we progressed as same as training data. The difference is we did not shuffle the data in validation. When we look at test data, again, we fixed the target size. In here, we give batch size 10. Because it's a hyperparameter, we try to have best performance from our model and finally decided to have batch size as 10. From now on, we will inform you about our models. We will describe the problems we had and how we managed and solved these problems. Eventually, we will present our best and final model. In this very first model that we trained, we had overfitting, and I will explain it later on. Also, in the following models, we did not have the best accuracy and test results that we were expecting. We solved these problems and came up with the best possible model. In our first model, we created a sequential model. For the layers, we used two-dimension convolution layer. This layer creates a convolution kernel that is convolved with the layer input to produce a tensor of outputs. The other layer we used for our first model is max pooling two-dimensional. In this layer, the pooling process is a filtering technique for the data in kernel. In other words, downsample the input along its spatial dimensions, which are height and weight, by taking the maximum value over an input window for each channel of input. Simply, it takes the maximum in the kernel. We choose to use ReLU and softmax functions for the activation function. Also, we use flattened layer in this model. It's simply preparing the data for the fully connected layer. The data in this neural network is the one-dimension array of matrices from the convolutional and pooling layers. Lastly, we use dense layer as our output layer. In this layer, all nodes in the previous layers are connected to nodes in the current layer. And our optimizer is Adam, which we thought that it's best for this model. Finally, we compiled and fitted our model.
Göksu, there is some steps per epoch or validation steps in the model fit as a parameter. Do you know the meaning of this?
Do I know what meaning? Epoch meaning?
Steps per epoch, validation steps.
I'm not sure.
Who knows this in your team?
I know.
Can I know too.
Okay. Could you explain, Mert?
Hocam, epochs like for loop.
I'm not talking about epochs. Steps per epochs. How do you calculate it?
Image numbers and over base size, actually.
What about validation steps?
It's again same.
What about validation
image numbers over base size?
What about you, Meta?
Actually, steps per epoch and validation steps same. These numbers are different because, for example, steps per epoch, we use the training. We use it in training. We divide it by three, our data. And epoch is Mert said, like a for loop. That's all.
Okay, do you think that the validation data is less than training data or not? Validation data is less than training data, right?
Yes.
How is it possible that the validation steps are larger than the steps per epoch?
Actually, it was our first model. We have some mistakes in here. It's overfit in the results. We will develop in the later. We will explain it, actually.
But Metan and Mert, do you understand why I'm asking this question? Because there should be some mistake in that parameter.
Yeah, you are right.
Yes, this is a mistake.
You are right, Hocam.
It's impossible. But
huge mistake.
Yes, huge mistake, but these models are...
Because you don't train your model according to, I think you use only three batch, right? So the first three steps you are using in each batch. You don't use the whole batch, I believe. Do you understand?
We corrected in the later, the other models, hocam.
Okay, but this in your presentation now I noticed that. So you are presenting me some incorrect parameters.
Want to show that, yes, we want to show that our mistakes.
Yeah, okay, I understood. But you didn't mention that, or your, now Göksu is presenting, right? Göksu should mention about it because nobody cares that steps per epoch cannot be less than validation steps is unusual. Because we expect that train data is much more than the validation data. So it takes only 3 steps in train, but 4 steps in validation. Do you believe that? So I think if you don't know the meaning of the parameters, you can just copy and paste some numbers and you need to calculate these numbers. In that code, I don't see the calculation code here. You need to provide the calculation code here. You need to get the train data set size divided by the batch size. Am I right? And you need to get the floor of it, not ceiling. Okay. So I think you understand me, Mete and Mert.
Yes, hocam. Actually, we will show the other slides.
Yeah, okay, but there should be some code, line of code, showing that how you calculate these, not 3, not 4 here. You cannot put the numbers here. Do you understand me that? You need to put the equation here. So automatically be calculated. Okay?
Okay, hocam, you understand.
Okay. Let's continue.
We train our model in 30 epochs, and it's clearly seen that the difference between the train data accuracy and validation accuracy is very high. Next, please. As we can see in the figure, you can understand that the difference in here caused overfitting in our first model, so we decided not to progress in this model, and we try to do a better one.
Hello, I'm Bengisu Danay and I will continue. At this point, we start training a model again. Since the pre-process part of our model is the same, you can see the part where we trained the model here. I will tell you about this code in general. Firstly, we create an empty sequential and we will complete the layers by adding to it's in other parts of the code, and we create the model thanks to two-dimensional convolution function in the second line. As a parameter here, 128 is a number of filter that the dimensionality of the output space, and 3x3 is a kernel size that's specifying the height and width of the 2D convolutional window that can be single integer to specify the same value for all spatial dimensions. Here the input shape is the size of the images we provide. The lastly padding means that output has the same size and the input and same means padding with zeros evenly to the left, right or up to down of the input. Then the batch normalization is a method used to make artificial neural networks faster and more stable and rescaling. Also, ELO uses the keyword augmentation input shape when using the layer as the first layer in a model. Then we use the max pooling function is operating for 2D spatial data. Down samples in the input along to its spatial dimension by taking the maximum value over the input window for each channel of the input. And here the pool size is 2x2 that will take the max value over a 2x2 pooling window. If only one integer specified, the same window length will be used for both dimensions. The last function we used while creating the this layer is dropout. It's randomness has sets input units to a zero with a frequency of rate and it steps during the training time, then which helps prevent overfitting. The value we entered in this function is our rate value. Rate is a fraction of input units drops. Also, there is a hyperparameter is alpha. I explained the shortly hyperparameter. Hyperparameter is used to control learning process. The other word we can say that the algorithm parameter that have no effect on the performance of the model, but affect the speed and performance. The parameter alpha is defined for activation function in Keras. It has a default value is 1. Then we continue to create our layers by doing these steps. After the finishing creating the layer, we first use the flatten function to output. Flattens the input does not affect the batch size. Also, we use the dense function. Dense implies the operation where activation is the element activation function past the argument kernel weights matrix created by layer. Also, I explained the dense function parameters. 512 is a unit that dimensionality of the output space. Then kernel constraint is a weights incident to each hidden unit to have a norm less than or equal to value. And regularization is applied to L2 penalty. In this way, we try to prevent overfit. Before the finishing the model, we finally use the activation function softmax. It's a converse effector of a values to probability distribution and is often used to activation for the last layer of the classification network because the results could be interpreted as a probability distribution. Then we compile the model according to loss and optimization defined in the last lines. The reason why we use the ADAM in the optimizer section method based on the adaptive estimation of first order or second order models. Next slide.
Beyim Yusuf, could you please go one back? First of all, I would like to emphasize that you are talking the functions. These are not functions. These are layers.
Yes.
Flatten is not a function. Flatten is a layer. Dense is not a function. Dense is a layer. Is that clear?
Yes, yes.
First of all, this.
Sorry, my
Okay. The second thing, when we are creating model, of course, we need to try and see a number of hyperparameters, a number of layers, etc. So there could be different architectures, model architectures you need to consider try. But my simple idea is that, or it's everybody knows this, we need to keep it simple, the models. Now in that model, you have lots of parameters.
Yes.
So it's not a good idea.
You are a teacher and next model is a simple and developed.
Because otherwise you cannot explain or justify why, for example, some dense layer has the kernel constraint, max norm 3, kernel regularizer, L2. You cannot explain, you cannot justify this kind of very specific things. So there are lots of options in every layer in Keras in general. But the general approach is that to keep these things simple. If you know very sure what you are doing, of course you can set up these values and you can use these parameters for the layers. But for such a classification problem, you don't need to be so specific. You don't need to be so specific. For example, ELU is not very common to use in image classification. Okay, so what I am suggesting that consider these models again, and maybe you came across these models from somewhere, but they are too specific, too much specific to some problem, but it's not your problem. So nobody can justify why some dense layers is like that, why some batch normalization comes at that stage. It's not easy to explain. So do you understand me?
Yes, yes, yes, teacher.
Okay. Bengusu, for you, I have a question. What is dropout layer? why we use drop-outly?
Also, I explained, but a dropout teacher, sorry, can you again the question?
Yes, what is a dropout layer? Why we use a dropout layer? For what reason?
Because input units, it steps during the training time, which help prevent the overfitting. We used to drop out layer.
Actually, dropout layers, do you think that they are active in train and test, or they are only active in train time?
Train time, I think.
Yes. Thank you. Okay, you are right.
Thank
Let's
you.
Continue things.
Thank you. You have you can see in the graph with the sequential model too. In the left graph, you have seen we pilot the error rates on training and validation data, and the horizontal axis number of periods, and the vertical axis is the error date. We need to stop training when the error rate of the validation data is a minimum. So we, as we increase the number of revolution, we had the model was memorized itself, so we have a very low accuracy value. It is approximately 0.65. Also, in the
Thank you, sir. Can I ask a question?
Yes, teacher.
Have you heard early stopping?
Sorry?
Have you heard early stopping?
I heard, but I don't know what this means.
Okay. Any other team members? Early yes. stopping.
Yes, I heard hocam.
Yes, teacher.
What is that, Mert or Meta?
It stop enough accuracy you got when you got.
Meta?
The other one?
Yes. Yes, same. Smart.
Can you define what is early stopping, Meta?
It is model is training when we collecting
okay so
when we collecting, monitor the improvement and when the improvement is stopped we can stop the train.
Yes. So please learn this method when you are dealing with a deep learning model. You can use early stopping by monitoring some validation accuracy, for example, if does not improve for patients, for three patient type, then you can, the model itself automatically stops training. So please use early stopping parameter in your models, okay?
Okay, hocam.
Let's continue.
Previous slide, Mert. In the loss graph on the right, training loss shows how well the model fits the training data, while the validation loss shows how well the model fits the new data. At this point, we see that we do not have a problem with losses and the model is applied with the data. Our problem is the accuracy. Next slide. Also, we developed the model and ResNet. ResNet is now short for neural network. This is a this model is an version of the conventional neural network, and ResNet model aims to solve the problem of performance degradation of CNN networks. As the depth increased, the accuracy stutters, but then tends to drop rapidly. Also, we used to ReLU activation this model. ReLU is the responsible for converting the total weight. Also, the ReLU is that the easier to train and gives the better performance than other activations because of the use this is. For the last layer, we use the softmax again because softmax converts to last probability value that is the output type that we want. Also, in line 117, layer trainable to false moves all the layers waves from trainable to non-trainable. And we complete the model. This optimizer is Adam, and these are some parameters. Next slide. The values you can see on the slides are the result of the, our model with the 30 epochs. Our final accuracy is a 0.78, and as the sum of the layers are straight is a accuracy is a 0.66 and loss is 0.18. As a result of the, these values, we decide that our model did not give a good result. Next slide. As can see from the graph, we could not get the result we want. So at this point, we decide to develop a new model, and Mark, we will open this new model.
Hi everyone, I am Mert İhsan. I will explain our best model cause and results, how we change and how we tune hyperparameters. My teammates explain some layers, but I will explain the other ones. We use ImageNet weights. Also include top false means that we are using in the here global average pooling. For using that, we need to false that, set to false. In here, layer trainable to false because this code also freezing. The state of the frozen layer won't be updated during the training. I mean that it won't train existing weights. Also, we had some problem when we convert the TensorFlow Lite model. It was return same output in each different photos. We tried to find that problem, and it takes 4 weeks. How we solved? We are scaling in the photos in the model in here. And in every test photos, the output will be different. In the categorical cross entropy, I will explain it. Categorical cross entropy is a loss function that is used into multi-class classification tests. Why we are using, if you ask this question. These are tests where our example can only belong to one out of many possible categories, and the model must decide which one. And we have six output because we have six class, and we are using softmax because we will show the results on the mobile phone. We are converting the probability, and we multiply with 100, and it gives our prediction accuracy. In here, we tune the hyperparameter. First of all, we tried with 5 epoch, and the result is what is not good, actually. In the 10 epoch, as you can see, a little bit more good. In the 15 epoch, it looked like 10 epochs figure, but it's more efficient than. And we will look at 20 epoch. It's more generalized with 98 training accuracy and 96 validation accuracy. In the test part, we predict unseen photos. In here, we predict test photos in each tensor. We get maximum value of them and what mesh with the class numbers. In 54 photos, our mistakes is 2, which is Kaplan-Postu type of normal, as you can see in here. It must be 3. As you know, accuracy is not enough to measure quality of the model. We need to look at different performance evaluation metrics. In the confusion metrics and the classification report, we can easily we can see our model quality. Let's look at. In the classification report, there is true positive in here, true negative in here, and false positive, false negative sides. In the support section, our test data is balanced, but not enough number. We will improve that. According to that, our matrix calculated in the confusion matrix. In here, F1 score is good metric when the data is in balance, but our data is already balanced situation. You can see in here, our accuracy is 0.96, but in the later we will see that it will decrease somehow. I will explain. There is a rock elk graph, actual figure. As you can see, there are slopes. First of all, I will explain rock and elk. The rock curve is a very important performance measure for classification problems. Rock is probability curve and the area under it, elk, represent the degree or measure of separability. As you can see, there are some slopes in here, for example, in here. In our example, our model has some mistakes in the Kaplan post-merval in here. There is two mistakes in the Kaplan post out of 9. There are some because of this slopes in the other slides. With the advice of our supervisor, thanks to that, we added another class type of merbles, other type merble. We add new class which is consist of different 18 type of merbles photos. In each merble type contains 10 photos because of balancing the data. In total, there are 180 photos with different 18 merble types. And we will train. As you can see, our recurrence rate has decreased to 86 with number of 20 epoch. As you can see. As you can see, it's not, actually it's quite good. Hocam, are you here?
Yes, we are.
Okay. Okay, hocam. In the figure, it looks like good, but we will look at performance metrics. As you can see, the accuracy will decrease. It was in the here 86, but in here it decreased to 83. In the Afio Beyaz, there are seven mistakes actually. The other marbles, some mistakes in the here. This Afyon Gri, it predicts 7 correct out of 9, 2 of them incorrect. You can see in precisions, we call F1 scores. Afyon Beyaz is bad actually. As you can see, our mistakes have increased while classifying them here. Accuracy, which was 86, dropped to 83. In the rock egg results, there are some changes in this figure. Since the number of arrows has increased, the curves are more and more obvious. You can see in here. In the Afyon Beyaz marble type, there are a lot of mistakes. You can see there are slotting starting here. It goes like the classification accuracy more low than others. We tried to with 30 epochs. We tuned the hyperparameter. In here, as you can see, our validation accuracy is decreased. It might be overfit. We have to check it, actually. It quite look like overfit, but we will look at the performance metrics. As you can see, it might be overfit. We don't know. In the performance metrics, as you can see here, while validation accuracy was 86 in 20 epochs, it was 83 in the classification report, but in the 30 epoch, our validation 77, but in the classification report is 89. That is, the accuracy of the model may not be truly accurate. Performance metrics should be also be checked. We checked the performance metrics, and here is different, higher accuracy it gives us. There is 30 epochs rock egg results with. In the figure, we will look at the slopes again. You can observe the which class more truly classified under the east slope failure increase. In the third epoch, you can see Afyon Beyaz is good results, but in the Kaplan postu, there is a problem, actually. Finally, we decided to 23 epochs, it will be good for us. We train with 23 epochs. Everything looks good, but let's have a look at performance metrics. It's clearly same accuracy and validation accuracy, but we will check it performance metrics.
May I ask a question for that slide, the previous slide?
Of course, hocam. This one?
Yes. Mert, in several similar slides about validation accuracy and the validation loss here, yes, you see that there are very steep fluctuations. You see that it goes down very strictly and then up and down and up. You notice that?
In the validation steps,
yes,
right?
Yes.
You are right, hocam.
Right. How can you explain this?
I don't know. It's something like about weights or something. I don't know.
No, it's not like that. Metan, okay. Do you have an idea?
Actually, no, teacher.
Okay, Bengisu.
Actually, I don't know, teacher.
Okay, Göksu. Göksu, do you have an idea, Göksu? I think Göksu is not here.
I guess there is a problem with her connection.
Okay. So actually, this is a very popular pattern when you have very few number of samples. Because in your validation, you have very few number of samples. So it depends on the each after the each epoch, your model learns something, right? And try to learn new things. But when you apply this model on your validation data, which is very, very few, only 63 samples, you can come up with very different results, even for a little change in the model weights. Do you understand the reason? Right?
Yes, John.
Instead of 63, for example, if you would have 600 samples in the validation, you wouldn't see this. It can get smooth loss and accuracy in validation. So that's why you are seeing these strict high fluctuations in validation with validation data. Is that clear for everyone?
I understand, hocam. We will increase our data as we discussed.
The train data is important, but the validation data size is also important. Otherwise, if you move on to next slide. The training results. There is some training results showing. Yes, here, for example, look at the validation accuracy on the right. For example, 79, 85, 86, 82, 84. You see that here, the fluctuation?
Yes.
Excuse me. That's the reason, because in the accuracy in data set, train data set, you also notice that there is the fluctuation, but less, because train data set has a little bit more samples compared to the validation data set. So in general, if you are training a deep learning model, you need lots of data in training and in validation, both of them. Is that clear for all of you?
Clear, hocam.
With so few data, you cannot even get the initial results correctly. So you try to tune the hyper parameters, but actually you cannot do it because the validation data is very few. Okay, yeah. Not this.
We need to collect more data.
Yes. Apply the augmentation, for example, much more augmentation, and as we discussed at the beginning of the slides.
Yes.
For your presentation, you need to apply. Okay. But thank you for sharing these metrics. If you move on the metrics, so you talk about this. Yes, precision recall F1 score and the macro weighted average. So please, everybody in each team, if you are multi-class classification, everybody need to use these and ready to explain. And of course, the next one, the next slide, of course, you need to talk about the area under curve. One, the rock or receiver operating characteristic metric as well. You did it well on that. Okay. You can continue if you have more thing to cover.
We have little things. So I will.
Okay.
We will deploy our model in Android Studio. That's why we use TensorFlow Lite.
Okay, we can stop at this time, because as Velit would like to show us the mobile one, we are gonna talk about this sharing, serving the model next other weeks. Okay, for the moment, we don't need to get into the detail. Okay.
Okay, John.
Matt, we present other week.
Okay, do you want to continue or?
In your email, there was a explanation about mesh shape, deploying the mobile.
We will discuss the deploying the model later, okay?
Okay, hocam.
Not this time.
Okay, hocam.
So we can conclude your presentation, I believe.
Thanks for listening.
Okay, thank you. Please note my concerns about your data. It is really few. Okay.
We will use GAN algorithm as we discussed before. I hope we will increase that numbers.
Okay. Thank you for the presentation.
Thank you, John.
Thank you, teacher.